Welcome, my name is Raffaele Hillebrand and I'm Associate Professor for Philosophy of Science, Engineering and Technology here at Delft University at the Faculty of TPM, Technology Policy Management. I will talk today about risk, uncertainty and ignorance and how they can be dealt with in decision making. Now, this is an important topic when it comes to responsible innovation, because we face these problems every time we talk about the unwanted side effects of a new or even of an existing technology. I will talk about climate change as a study case. And when we talk about the risks about climate change, it is important to be sure about what the term risk means. So usually when we use the term risk colloquially, we use risk in the following two sentences, like smoking increases the risk of cancer, or this uncovered hole in the ground is a risk. Now, while in the first sentence we can replace risk by probability, likelihood, possibility, this does not make sense in the second sentence. We use risk here synonymous for harm or danger. Now, when every time we talk in science or in philosophy about risk, we use risks to cover both harm as well as the uncertainty of its harm. So sometimes we may assign uncertainties to the harm that actually occur, and it is indeed the natural, the engineering sciences, sometimes the social sciences, that provide us with the probability, for example, that a certain valve in a nuclear power plant will break. However, now, on the other hand, what constitutes a harm always requires a normative concept, and that goes beyond the sciences and requires some ethical expertise. For example, we need to know why climate change is actually a harm. We need a normative concept that tells us why we do have to care about people living in the future in 2100, for example. So hence, risk is per se an interdisciplinary concept, and this has important consequences. Now, first, anthropocentric ethics tell us that climate change is in itself is not a harm, but rather the implications that it has for human beings. These implications are actually not modeled with the climate models we usually talk about, but they require so-called welfare economic impact models, which are done by economists. Hence, better political decisions as to how to react to the threats of climate change may not require better climate models, that's what we're doing at the moment a lot, but better climate impact models. And this is an area of research not nearly as active as climate models today. Second implication of risk as an interdisciplinary construct is that the ethical, the normative evaluation needs at least in parts to precede the empirical scientific prognosis that analyze the uncertainty of a certain harm. Now, in cases where the uncertainty can be quantified in terms of probability, we often use risk in a very narrow meaning of the term, namely as mean harm, that is harm times probability its occurrence. Now, talking about climate change, here's a citation from the 2007 report of the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, and it predicted that by doubling of CO2, the temperature rise is likely to be in the range of 2 degrees to 4.5 degrees Celsius, with a best estimate of about 3 degrees. And it is very unlikely to be less than 1.5 degrees. Values substantially higher than 4.5 degrees cannot be excluded. While in the 2007 report, terms like likely, very likely, unlikely were still associated with probability ranges. For example, likely refers to probabilities larger than 66%. The latest IPCC report from the last and this year does not provide any probability estimates anymore. Now, without these probability estimates for the occurrence of this harm, we actually say in technology assessment that we are not actually facing a decision under risk, but we face a decision under uncertainty. So now, what is the difference between the two? While for decisions under risk, we know all possible outcomes, that means we know the full probability space, and we can assign meaningful probabilities. Now, uncertainty refers to a situation where we still know the full probability space, but cannot assign meaningful probabilities to all outcomes, so to all aftermaths our CO2 emissions can have. We further distinguish in technology assessment ignorance, a situation where we don't even know the full probability space. These latter, the decisions under ignorance, became recently pretty popular by Donald Rumsfeld, who termed them the unknown unknowns, or Nassim Taleb, who called them the black swans. Now, mitigating climate change is an example for a decision under uncertainty, while if you want to look for a decision under ignorance with the benefit of hindsight, we may use the CFCs, the introduction of the CFCs in the 1970s, because at the time of the market release of CFCs, the damaging effect on the ozone layer could not have been known. Now, this distinction between risk, uncertainty, and ignorance commonly rests on a certain interpretation of probabilities. This is a so-called objective interpretation, and they are commonly used in technology assessment and also in large parts, actually, of engineering and science. And they take probabilities to be equal to relative frequencies. They're advocates of opposing views. This is a so-called subjective view on probabilities. And they take probabilities to be synonymous to grades of beliefs instead of relative frequencies. This is sometimes referred to as the so-called Bayesian approach. Now, in theory, this would blur our distinction between risk, uncertainty, and also ignorance. Now, in practice, for climate change, assigning subjective probabilities remains fragmentary always, as two reasons. First, we cannot update our beliefs. And second, we cannot assign meaningful prior probabilities in order to make sense of the Bayes formula. So it becomes really difficult. So in dealing with climate change, we clearly have a decision under uncertainty. Now, how to deal with risk and uncertainty? For risk, we may use what is known as maximizing expected utility analysis, or formulated negatively, risk minimization or risk analysis. So this is nothing but the actually utilitarian paradigm of the greatest good for the greatest number. But as we do not know the exact outcome of our actions, we can only maximize the expected good or utility, or again put negatively, minimize the expected damage or risk. A typical example for such an approach is policies as regards nuclear power. When no suitable probability estimates, however, are available, like in the case of climate change, this approach is, of course, not applicable. We just don't have probability estimates. We must fall back onto so-called elementary decision approaches, elementary meaning that they do not require any probability estimates. And the most prominent example of such an approach in environmental and engineering ethics is the so-called precautionary principle. Now, the precautionary principle is used in many different ways. Most of these are variants of the two forms I want to talk about here. The first one, cited here from the Declaration on Environment and Development in 1992, reads, "Where there are threats of serious or irreversible damage, lack of full scientific evidence shall not be used as a reason for postponing cost-effective measures to prevent environmental degradation." This version is often referred to as a weak formulation of the precautionary principle, because it advises us to also take into account possible implications of technologies where full scientific certainty is not available. However, it does not say anything as to how to deal with such uncertain situations. We may still be able to perform a risk analysis, for example. We just need to make sure that we consider even the uncertain effects as well. But how we do that, we don't know. Now, the second formulation reads, "In its simplest formulation, the precautionary principle has a dual trigger. If there is a potential for harm from an activity, and if there is uncertainty about the magnitude of impacts or causality, then anticipatory measures, action, should be taken to avoid harm." Now, this second formulation is called the strong formulation because it advises us how to act. It tells us even when the harm is uncertain, then anticipatory action should be taken to avoid it. So no matter how unlikely a negative impact is, and no matter how unsure we are that it's going to happen, and no matter how unsure we are about the severity, we need to take action to avoid this. Now, applying this to climate change means that we need to mitigate any impacts climate change may have. That comes in quite handy that some economic studies suggest that reducing anthropogenic greenhouse gas emissions is not very costly. For example, the so-called Stern report from 2007 told us that we actually only need an annual investment of 1% of the global GDP to avoid main damages caused by global warming. This would amount to about $450 billion per year. Now, it's hard to grasp such a big figure, but we can put it into relation with other figures. For example, the $1.3 billion per annum, which are estimated to fulfill one of the UN's so-called Millennium Goals, that is to provide 80% of the rural population of Africa with safe water and sanitation. Now, this comparison shows pretty well that a simple application of the precautionary principle simply fails short to adequately account for this comparison. If we invest 1% of GDP per year to avoid climate change, this money is just not there for other goals. So it is a dilemma we are facing. So how to decide? And this is not a question that can be answered in a quick lecture, but it needs a lot of political debate that is currently falling short. And moreover, it needs an interdisciplinary approach to risk and uncertainty in which not only the harm, but also the likelihood of its occurrence needs to be taken into account. Irrespective of the fact whether this likelihood is quantified in terms of probabilities or not. So goodbye and thank you for your attention.